So last week what we discussed was on photo detectors. So we discussed about the basic principles of noise, how noise is generated, what are the different types of noises found in, especially in photon detectors, and we derived equations to derive the total noise as shot noise and thermal noise both. And we discuss about performance parameters of a photon detector. And these were the parameters that we had discussed. So now today, what we will be doing is we'll take one type of photon detector, which is a photodiode, and then we will see the working principle of that particular photon detector. Then you will have some understanding about how a photon detector really works and what are the modes of operation of that photon detector. There's no time to discuss all of the types of photon detectors available in the world, but we'll be considering only one. So when it comes to photon detectors, there are different kinds of photon detectors. And in high level, they can be categorized as photoemissive detectors. They are, so the external photoelectric effect had we had discussed at the beginning of this lecture series, which is that when photons are incident on some device, not like semiconductors, but especially for metals, electrons will be emitted. That means a photo current will be generated. So we are not interested on those photon detectors in this course. Right, so we are only dealing with the internal photo electric effect, which is photoconductive detectors, where the semiconductors are going to generate the photo current using the internal photoelectric effect. And so this Dungsten photodiode also can be categorized under this part B. So this is an example actually of this part B, but as we are discussing about this one, we will be considering it as a separate category, right? So here we have listed several examples for photon detectors. And what we'll be discussing is just a simple PN photodiode, simply a diode, which consists of a homo junction, not a hetero junction, but a homo junction. So you learned in LEDs that when a diode is biased in forward biased, it will act as a light emitting diode. So in order for a diode to act as a photo detector, it should be biased as reverse biased, right? So when you make a diode reverse biased, it will act as a photodiode. That means the mode of operation will be changed. And in order to, in addition to that, there are several other types of photo detectors. So in PIN, there are two junctions. There is a PI junction and IN junction, where the photo detection takes place in between this P and N junction, actually in the I region. Right. So likewise, there are different photo detectors which have been listed here: heterojunction, Schottky photodiodes, avalanche photodiodes, guided wave photo detectors, like this. So what we are interested only is the PN photodiode. So there are different working principles in these other types. But once you learn one type, you will be able to apply that knowledge and understand the other types. But we will not be testing on this one, but we are specifically interested in this type. But for your project, you can select any of these or any other sensor you want. Right, so when it comes to PN photodiode especially, so what we'll be discussing here is the direct gap. So about direct gap, you must have remembered by now, in direct gap, the minimum of the conduction band and the maximum of the valence band occurs at the same wave number or same momentum, in other words. So that when energy is absorbed, that means when light is incident on the diode, it will cause an energy absorption, and this electron will be absorbing that energy and going to a higher energy level. That is what happens in photon detectors. When light is incident, energy is absorbed and electrons are going to higher energy levels, right? So that it will generate a photo current. How the photo current generates, we will be discussing in a moment. So before generating photo current, so this absorption of energy must take place, right? So as I told you, it is having a homojunction, right? So this photon is absorbed and excited to a upper energy level. Right. So in order to understand how the photocurrent is generated in PN junction photodiodes, you must understand the regions. So in LEDs, we were not discussing about this depletion layer. That is because, so here is the place where the junction is there. Here, this side, left side is the P side, right side is the N side, and here you have the PN junction. So at the junction, what happens? So due to the difference in charges, the majority carriers, the majority carriers in the P side is holes. The majority carriers in the N side is electrons. So P side holes try to diffuse. So diffusion, first you must understand what is diffusion. So I have defined diffusion here. So diffusion is the process of movement of charge carriers due to concentration gradient. So diffusion is a natural phenomenon. So in Sinhala, you call this visarana. So that means whenever there is a concentration difference, there will be flow of matter from higher concentration to a lower concentration in order to balance the concentration. It is a natural phenomenon which will occur from higher to lower concentration. So in P side, you have higher concentration of holes. In N side, you have low concentration of holes. So holes will be diffused into N side region. And in similarly, N side is having higher concentration of electrons, and P side is having low concentration of electrons. Therefore, electrons will diffuse. That means move naturally from N side to P side. So when electrons move, so there is holes in this region. So first what will happen is these electrons will neutralize the holes in the P side, and it will create a charge depleted region, which is called the depletion layer. Because when the electrons are diffused, the excess holes charges will be neutralized. And similarly, when holes move to this side, in the middle, some of those diffusing holes will come into contact with electrons, excess electrons in the N side, and the electrons will be neutralized by moving holes, so that there will be a depletion layer. But we did not see this in LEDs because the depletion layer is very thin or very narrow when forward biased. When forward biased, this depletion layer is almost cancelled out. So we did not have, we did not take that very thin depletion layer into consideration. What we were discussing was only this diffusion regions. So you must have remembered this diffusion region when it comes to lasers and LEDs. So as electrons are diffused into this region, so some of them will be depleted and there will be excess electrons in this diffusion region. That means in P side, there will be excess minority electrons. Similarly, in the N side, there will be excess majority, sorry, excess minority holes in the N side. So in the N side diffusion region, you have H plus, I mean holes. In the P side diffusion region, you have electrons, right? Okay, so when it came to LEDs and lasers, you saw that this is the active region. And we forgot about, I mean, we almost didn't discuss about the depletion layer. But when it comes to PN junction photodiodes, it is inherently working in the reverse bias mode, so that in reverse bias mode, this depletion layer is thick. The thickness of the depletion layer we cannot neglect. It is relatively high. Due to that, we have to consider this depletion layer also, right? Okay, so how the photocurrent is generated in photodiodes? That is, first, the photons must be absorbed and electrons must be excited to a higher energy level. So this excitation can take place in any place. So it can be taken place in this homogeneous P region. So homogeneous region means where you have only the extrinsic P side. If it is P side, that means P type, it has some concentration or some homogeneous concentration level of majority carriers, not like these regions where you have excess minority carriers here. Here there is the charge is depleted. Here you have excess minority carriers holes in here. But in homogeneous regions, it is just like the original semiconductor material which were doped. Right? So this excitation of electrons, or in other terms, photon absorption can take place in any of these regions, homogeneous, diffusion, or depletion. But we must consider only the areas that will contribute to the photocurrent. So you will realize in a moment that all of these transitions will not contribute to the photocurrent, right? So you will see that only these two regions, I mean, this diffusion region, this depletion region, and this diffusion region will contribute to the photocurrent. And why this does not contribute, you will see when in a moment when you discuss about the next type of current, which is called the drift current. So as I told you, it can take place in any point, but the active region is this, right? So I have added a reminder also here that in LEDs and I mean in lasers also. So what was the active region? We told that the active region consists of diffusion region. So you must know that graph where the diffusion region, the excess magnetic area graph, where with distance the excess magnetic areas are decreasing, like a dumbbell shape, right? So in there we told that it is the diffusion region, but actually the depletion region is also there, but we did not consider because the depletion region is very thin in forward bias, so we can neglect it. Okay, so that is some reminder. Okay, so now we will come into this concept which is called drift current, which is the current which is actually contributing to the photo current. So first, what you should need to understand, what is drifting? So drifting is movement of charge carriers due to net electric field in the depletion layer. So what is this net electric field? So in your advanced level, you must have understood about the barrier potential or the barrier voltage. So due to the diffusion, when excess majority carriers are coming into this side, there is a tendency, I mean, so these holes will, in this depletion layer, what will happen is these holes will recombinate, right? Recombinate with the electrons in this. So initially this layer was N side. This side was P side. So what happened? Holes moved from P to this side and neutralized the excess electrons. So when the excess electron is neutralized, so you have positive ions, or in other terms called cations. Cations are generated in this side. The net charge is neutral, but when it comes to, so the atom will look like a positive. So similarly, there are majority electrons in this side because this side was initially N. So in N side, there are excess majority electrons. So they will be moving towards this side. They will be moving towards this side. So there is a tendency for the electrons to accumulate in this region. In this region. So there is negative ions. The concentration of negative ions in this side will be higher, and the accumulation of cations in this side will be high. But don't misunderstand that there is a charge here. The net charge is zero, but there is a tendency for the charge, positive charge, to accumulate in this side and negative charge for accumulating in this side, because holes were drifted in this direction. Holes are drifted in this direction, and diffused. Holes were diffused in this direction because of this concentration gradient. Holes were diffused in this direction, and electrons were diffused in this direction. So there is a tendency for the cations to accumulate in this side and anions to accumulate in this side. This is a tendency. Because of that tendency, there is a net electric field from N side to P. So because of this one, so the electric field exists from positive to negative. So due to this, there is a tendency for the electric field which is acting in this side. So this exists inside the depletion layer. So this happened because of diffusion, because of this concentration gradient. There is a net electric field. So if you consider the forward bias, so the positive terminal is connected to this side and negative terminal is connected to this side. So this barrier voltage, so this is called the barrier voltage, because this is in opposite to the forward bias voltage. Forward bias voltage, this electric field is in opposite direction to the forward bias voltage. So it is called a barrier voltage. So this barrier voltage or this electric field is the one which is causing this drift current, what is called as a drift current. So drift current is defined as movement of charges due to this net electric field in the depletion layer. So when, so assume that there is an excitation of an electron due to incident photons in the depletion layer. So in depletion layer, electron went here. So there is an electron here, and so in the depletion layer you have this electric field. So in reverse bias, this electric field is enhanced because the reverse bias is supporting this electric field. That's why in reverse bias this region is thick. In forward bias, the forward bias voltage is acting against this electric field. That's why the depletion layer is cancelled out, or maybe very, very thin in the forward bias condition, because the forward bias voltage is acting against this electric field. So what we are now considering is reverse bias. So there is a very thick depletion layer and electric field. So when an electron is excited by an incident photon, so due to this electric field, so this electric field represents the direction of motion of holes. So electron will drift in this direction. And when electron is excited to this level, it will automatically create a hole in the low energy level. So that hole will be drifting in this direction, right? So the direction of drift current is the same direction as the barrier electric field. So what will happen? When an electron is excited in the diffusion region. So in diffusion region, when an electron is excited to this level, right? So in diffusion region, you have excess minority electrons. So due to having excess minority electrons, and when added with this excited electron, right? So those excess minority electrons and electrons generated by incident photons will also be drifting in this direction, because the electron motion is in this direction and hole motion is in this direction. So if here you have H plus diffusion region, that means you have excess H plus, right? You have excess H plus, and when the incident photon create these electrons and create a hole, then those holes combined with excess minority holes, all of them will be drifting towards this, right? Okay, sorry about that. So I got a phone call. So what I was discussing was, so this drift current will cause actually this photo-generated carriers to drift. That means when the incident photon will excite some electrons and create electron hole pairs, holes will be drifting in this direction and electrons will be drifting in this direction. In addition, the excess minority carriers will also contribute to the drift current. So drift current is the one which is causing photoelectric current using, I mean, the intrinsic photoelectric effect, right? So this drift current is desirable in the process of photon detectors, right? When it comes to photon detectors, this is the current which is desirable for functioning effectively, right? So these charges are said to be immobile. So that thing you already know. So these cations and anions are the ones which cause this electric field, right? So these things I already described, right? Okay. And so this the direction of drift current is important. So as you can see, the drift current is in this direction. So if you consider the forward bias current, the forward bias current is in from left to right. Forward bias current is left to right, drift current is right to left. So it is in reverse direction to the forward bias current, right? Okay. So for photo current, so that's why you need to have the diode biased in reverse bias mode, because you cannot have the photo current by if you bias it forward, then it will be another mode. So in order to get the photoelectric mode, well, this is called the photoconductive mode. So there are three modes that a diode can exist. So we will be discussing all three modes. One mode actually you had already learned in LEDs and lasers. And this is the second mode that we are discussing. And in a future lesson, when we will be seeing the other mode, which we'll be discussing, that is the photovoltaic mode, right? So as I explained previously, this excess minority carriers are also drifted by this electric field. So it will be contributing for the drift current, right? And they are swept due to this electric field in the diffusion region. So in that's why in photon detectors, I mean specifically in PN photodiode in reverse bias mode, the diffusion and depletion layer are considered as the active region. And if you consider the homogeneous region, so you can have an electron excited to high energy level using the incident light in this region also. But in this region, it is much away from this electric field. It is much away from the electric field, and also only that photo-generated carrier is there. There are no excess minority carriers to support the drift current. So the homogeneous region, they will not contribute to the drift current. Even if this electron is dragged, for example, assume that, so the electrons are drifting in this direction. No? So assume that due to maybe some small effect, this electron was drifted here. So in the process, either it will be exist in the diffusion region, or maybe that electron may be recombined in the depletion layer, right? So because of those reasons, we do not consider the homogeneous region. As I told you, one is that the distance from the electric field, and the other is there are no excess minority carriers to support the motion. And due to the distance in the process of, even if they are drifted, they will be either remaining in the diffusion region, or recombining the depletion layer, right? Okay, so that's what we are saying here as the active region. In the homogeneous region, that's why I told you, in the homogeneous region, they will not cause active drift current, right? So it will either recombine or exist in the diffusion region. That's what happens. That's why it is not considered. So it is not considered as the active layer, right? So what about the diffusion current, right? So initially, this depletion layer was not there. Initially, this depletion layer was not there. What happened was, due to this concentration gradient, holes moved in this direction, electrons moved in this direction. So holes move in this direction means the diffusion current exists in this direction from left to right. Diffusion current exists from left to right. Left to right means in the forward bias current direction. In forward bias current direction. So as the diffusion current is in forward bias current direction, and the photo current is there in reverse bias direction. So this drift current is in reverse bias direction, reverse bias current direction. So the diffusion current is in forward bias direction. So the diffusion current is not desirable for a photodiode, because simply, if I explain, the direction is opposite to the drift current. Drift current is in reverse bias direction, diffusion current is in forward bias direction. So the diffusion current must be minimized. That's why it is undesirable for proper functioning of a photodiode. So now you must be able to understand why the depletion layer and diffusion layer are the active layers of a PN photon detector, where the drift current is generated, right? So as I told you, I'll remind once again that drift current is the one which is contributing for photo current. Okay, so in other terms, photodiode current. So due to this thing, so as the homogeneous region does not contribute for the drift current, so they act as barriers from both sides. So the P-type homogeneous region and both the N-type homogeneous region, they act as barriers for the drift current. Right, because in those regions, both drifting and diffusion, both are not taking place. They don't favor that process in homogeneous regions. Right, so these photon detectors are said to be having unity gain. So you saw last week that all of the energy of the photons are not going to be converted into a photo current, only some of the incident energy is going to be converted as electric power. So there is an efficiency which is called the extrinsic efficiency of the photon detector. So only some part is going to be converted. So the gain is less than one actually. So in order to amplify the photo current, you need to have an external circuitry, which is usually found in the modern sensor packages found in present world. So if you get the photon, I mean the photodiode only, the gain will be less than one for sure, because all of the energy is not going to be converted. Gain is less than one. In order to have the gain higher than one, you have to connect the output of the photodiode to an amplifier and get the output. Maybe you have to remove the external other noises. Maybe you have to filter. Maybe then you can amplify it. So at the end of this today's lecture, I will also explain that these sensors are not usually found in idle unless it is required to be idle for some specific applications. Some applications, the sensor, for instance, the photodiode only is required. But most of the time, these sensors are coupled with additional signal conditioning circuits, likewise amplification circuits, to get the output that the user wants. So that is another lesson we will discuss about after finishing this lesson. Right? Okay, so these equations you saw last week, that the photo current is equal to the extrinsic efficiency times the incident energy. I mean, so this PS is the incident power and E is the charge of an electron. So this is the, in other terms, this is the number of electrons produced. And this is the number of photons produced for a given time. That is a sampling time that we discussed last week, right? Okay, so this, you can see this photo current is a function of input optical power. And last week we saw how these characteristics vary. So you saw a graph. So in that current, I was the y-axis, P was the x-axis, and you saw that up to some point, this output current vary linearly, and after some time, it starts to saturate, right? So those characteristics we had already discussed. Okay, so in order, so now you saw that you need to have a barrier voltage or the barrier electric field in order for the photo current to be effective, or when light is incident on the photodiode, in order for the electrons or the photo current to be generated, you need to have it in reverse bias. So the bias voltage is important when it comes to photodiodes, right? Okay, so we have an equation for the output current of the photodiode. Here, this is so. This equation you must have seen in your advanced levels. So the current of a photodiode is equal to I naught times. So this I naught term is important. So I naught is considered the bias current under dark conditions. So what is dark condition? So if, for example, if you keep the diode in a dark room where there is no light, and if you bias the diode, then at that moment, the current flowing in the diode is called this I naught, right? So actually, this I naught is reverse bias, I mean, current flowing in the reverse direction. So that is the bias current which will flow when under dark conditions. So under dark conditions, the output current is a function of bias voltage and temperature. Bias voltage and temperature. So the output current is changing based on the bias voltage and temperature. So when the temperature changes, the output current also changes. Similarly, it's true for voltage. So voltage you can understand, but temperature, so according to this equation, when the temperature is high, so this term drops. That means the reverse bias current increases when the temperature is high. You can see when the temperature is high, this whole term becomes low, right? This whole term becomes low. When this is going to become low, so this minus value will increase. Then that means the reverse bias current will increase under high temperatures. When the temperature is low, this reverse bias current, this total reverse bias current will be low, right? So in other terms, I naught is called the reverse saturation current, or under dark conditions. This dark condition is important because in your A levels, you may not have considered what is this IS and this one, right? So this is in reverse direction, right? And this IS, right? So when you get this one, you will get a negative value, right? If it is a negative voltage. So if it is a positive voltage, you will get probably a positive value. When it is forward bias, you will get the positive value. So for example, consider the case V equals zero, then e to the power zero is one, one minus one is zero, then the I naught is zero, then only the photo generated current exists. And this IS can be given by this equation, and you can substitute here. So at last, the photo generated current is a function of voltage and the input optical power. And also we have made an assumption here that we have considered the temperature also as the constant here. Then only it will become a function of voltage and incident optical power. Otherwise, it will be a function of temperature also. Actually, it is a function of temperature also. But here we have assumed that the temperature is constant. In most of the cases, we assume that the temperature is constant because we cannot have many variables and discuss or analyze these concepts. That's right. Okay, so that is the equation. So if you get that equation graphically, what you will be getting is this. So I naught, I told you, it is under dark conditions. Under dark conditions, it will be something like this. So you can see, you can substitute negative voltage here. So when it is negative, you get a value less than one, then this term will automatically be a negative value. And when it is negative, this term is very gradually decreasing, very gradually decreasing, so that you can consider almost this one a constant. I mean, almost equal to I naught. because it is gradually decreasing. So these characteristics you must have seen. And what will happen when the light is incident? When light is incident, this term will increase. This term will increase. And what the effect is such that this curve will be shifted in this direction. In down direction. That means it will reduce this current to down. I mean, this is this capital I is considered forward bias current. So that's why you get a negative term here, because the photo current, you saw that the drift current, which is going to effect for the photo current, is in reverse direction. So reverse direction means in this direction. So this curve will be shifted in this direction when incident optical power is increasing. Right, so that same equation given here. Okay, so this is how it will be shifted under various optical illumination. And when the incident power is zero, we have the dark current characteristic, where you define this I naught. So this I naught is defined under dark conditions. Right, okay. So we will be seeing more about this one. So this is what I already told you. It is as proportional to the amount of photo current, this will be shifted downwards. The same thing is given here, in other words. Okay, so this is very important modes of PN junction diodes. So what is the mode discussed in a photodiode is this region. What we are interested is in this region only, where we call that region photoconductive mode or photoconductive region, right? Because with the incident photons, when the diode is in reverse bias, it will cause the reverse bias current to increase. Simply, reverse bias current will be increasing due to the increasing of drift current by photon absorption, right? Due to photon absorption, the reverse bias current will increase. So that increase is displayed here. So this photoconductive mode is the mode for a photodiode to act as a photodetector. But there are two other modes also. What is this mode? This is called the photo emission mode. And even though the name is new, you have already studied about this mode. This is the photo emissive, or the photo emission mode is the mode which LEDs and lasers perform. LEDs and lasers are going to perform in this region where you have a forward bias voltage and forward bias current. Forward bias voltage and forward bias current. And how we are going to change between these modes? That is by the way that we are biasing. So if you bias your diode with the forward bias current and forward bias current and forward bias voltage, it will be acting as an LED working in the photo emission mode. If you bias it as a negative current or reverse bias current and reverse bias voltage, it will act as a photo detector in photoconductive mode. And in addition, we have another mode called the photovoltaic mode, where the incident photons are not here. Here, the incident photons contribute to a photo current. And here in photovoltaic mode, the incident photons are going to generate a voltage, not a photo current. Actually, it is going to generate a voltage, and that voltage is forward bias. That voltage is forward bias. That generated voltage will be a forward bias. So in here, you have a reverse bias voltage and reverse bias current. In here, you have a forward bias voltage and reverse bias current. So we will not go in much into this photo emission mode as we have discussed it. What we'll be focusing is this photoconductive and photovoltaic modes specifically, but we will touch this one also. And as given here, there are three modes. These are the three modes. And how we are going to shift between these modes is by biasing the circuit in such a manner you get the required direction for the voltage and current. If you get a positive voltage, forward bias voltage and forward bias current, you get this. You get forward bias voltage and reverse bias current, you get photovoltaic mode. So how to shift? Shifting is simply by changing the bias circuit, right? Okay. So this photoconductive mode exists in the third quadrant. So if you divide this VI characteristic, so this ID stands for the diode current, VD stands for the diode voltage. You have this one as the first quadrant, second quadrant, third quadrant, and fourth quadrant. So this photoconductive mode exists in the third quadrant of this VI characteristic. And it includes this short circuit condition, which I have highlighted using this yellow color. So in short circuit condition, you have V equals zero. So this V equals zero and all of this are considered to be photoconductive mode. And the photovoltaic mode is the fourth quadrant, 1, 2, 3, 4, fourth quadrant, including the open circuit condition. So in open circuit condition, there is no connection. You have current equal to zero. So this red line, including this red line and fourth quadrant, excluding this one, not including this one, this belongs to this region. You have photovoltaic mode, where photons are going to generate forward bias voltage, right? So here also you have voltage, but you have that in reverse bias. You have that in reverse bias, and it will be decreasing. So as you will see in the next one, it will be decreasing, right? Okay, so these are the modes. And as I told you, the mode is shifted by changing the external circuit, which is specifically the bias circuit. And we'll see how to bias this one. We'll see how to bias this one. And we'll see how to bias this one. Each one in separately in this slide. Okay. So I have given here the same VI characteristic, but here additionally I have given you the external bias circuit required for each of the modes of the diode. And not only that one, but the DC load lines of each of the modes. And I will explain how I got those things, right? Okay, first we'll consider one by one. So first we will get this photoconductive mode. In photoconductive mode, what is the requirement? You have to have reverse bias voltage and reverse bias current. That means to act as a photo detector, right? before that, I will explain the notations that I have used to mark the voltage and current. So I have marked the forward bias voltage as VD and the forward bias current as ID, because we have to comply with the VI characteristic of the diode. So in the VI characteristic, this is the forward bias voltage, VD. This is the forward bias current, ID. So this is the diode symbol. So in this side you have P and in this side you have N. So the forward bias current runs from P to N. So this red arrow shows the direction of forward bias current, ID. And what is VD? VD is the forward bias voltage. Right? VD is the forward bias voltage. So when the current, the forward bias current is flowing in this direction, right? So the forward bias current is flowing, it is flowing from P to N side. P to N side. And the voltage, the forward bias voltage of the diode, then it will be in this direction. It will be in this direction, right? VD. So that is how it is notated in these circuits. So how to get the photoconductive mode? So photoconductive mode is by connecting an external voltage source to reverse bias the diode. So here you have N side. N side is now connected to the positive side of the external source. So you can see this is reverse bias now. This is reverse bias. And what is this RL? RL is the external load resistor. External load resistor, it is connected along with this diode. And capital RS is the internal resistance of the diode, or the photodiode, internal resistance. So the diode can have a finite resistance. That resistance is denoted by capital RS. So if you apply the Kirchhoff voltage law for this circuit, you get VD is in this direction. Right, VD is in this direction, and VR is in this direction, and as ID is flowing in this direction, IDRL is in this direction. IDRL is in this direction. So the ultimate equation resulting from that one will be VD equal minus VR minus IDRL. Or in other terms, if you move around this loop, it is VD plus VR plus IDRL equals zero, in other terms, right? So it will result VD equal minus VR plus minus VR minus IDRL. And if you consider, so the output voltage, V out, so V out, we have marked this one as positive and this one as negative, as the IDRL will be from top to bottom. This is the direction of IDRL. So V out is equal to minus IDRL. V out is equal to minus IDRL. Right? This is the output voltage. So how to draw this DC load line? So in order to draw this DC load line, you have to make ID as the subject of this equation. You can rearrange this equation. You can rearrange this equation and make ID the subject. When you make ID the subject, then you will have an equation in the form y equal mx plus c. Using that one, you can derive what is the value here and what is the value here. I have not done it here because of lack of space here. So you can, as a homework, you can subject this ID and check whether you get these intercept values, y-axis intercept and x-axis intercept. So it will intercept the x-axis or the ID equals zero. So you can substitute it here, ID equals zero, then VD is equal to minus VR. Yes, true. VD is equal to minus VR. And when you make VD equals zero, VD equals zero, then ID will come here minus VR over RL. Yes, this is that intersection. Right? So you have the DC load line like this. But in order to have this one, so you can see that, for example, if RL is high, this term is going to be reduced. That means this one will shift towards this one. So then the DC load line will look like something like this. Right? So DC load line. So what is this ID? ID is the diode current. So that means that if you get, then if you have RL as a high value, then you will have a characteristic like this one. Then that means ID can change only in this, that small area. But if you have RL, and that means the load resistor low, then you can have this intercept much below this one. That means something like this graph, Then you have this whole range of current values. Where you can get the output. That means the photocurrent can change in this area. So that means you have a higher range of values. So due to that one, it is desirable to have this load resistor much less than the internal resistance of the diode. Because when you get the whole resistance, the resistance is obtained by RS plus RL. When you have RL much less than RS, then the whole resistance will be decreasing. So then you get much higher current. So in order to get higher current, so the more the current you have, it is desirable in photoconductive mode as a photodiode. So this RL needs to be much lower. Right? Okay, so that is how this biasing is done for the photoconductive mode. So this is the condition. RL for the load resistor needs to be much less than RI. So that is the requirement. If you graphically explain, this intercept must go down graphically. Then you have much higher range of current values to change. If you cannot understand this one, you can understand using the graph. Okay, so that is this mode. And next I will go to photo emission mode, which you already know actually. And in this case, we need to bias the diode in a forward bias manner. So this VF is the forward bias voltage applied. And this is the forward ID is the forward bias current. So this ID and VD notations do not change. This is the forward bias voltage and forward bias current. And in this case, you have a diode in direction of the forward bias current, because you need to have forward bias current. And the bias voltage VF is also in, say, bias voltage is also in this, I mean, in the forward bias current direction, right? Okay, right. So if you write the Kirchhoff voltage law for this one, you get VF equal VD plus ID RL, because current flows in this direction. So you have voltage in this direction, VD plus ID RL. So now here I have rearranged this equation because you need to make ID the subject. So when you rearrange this, you get ID equal VF minus VD over RL. So what is the intercept? So if you get this one as Y equal MX plus C. So C is V of VF over RL. So C is VF over RL. And if you make ID zero, you get VD equal VF. So this is the point which this graph cuts. So this is the DC load line. This is the DC load line. And this diode current, this ID is almost linear in this region. So you get a linear DC load line. Here also you get a linear DC load line, but here you get a logarithmic load line for the photovoltaic mode. So we'll discuss that when we come to this mode. First we will see this mode. Right, so in here you can see that so VD equal VF minus ID RL. So that means VD is positive and it is the minimum value is zero and the maximum value is the bias voltage supply. The maximum value of the forward bias voltage is the external bias voltage supply. That is obvious. So this mode, you know, there is nothing much to explain in this mode, right? Okay, so we'll see more about this mode. So what is the equation? V out, or the output voltage, is equal to minus IDRL in this mode. And it is also true in this mode also, right? Okay, so what is meant by this requirement is the requirement for photoconductive mode. So we need to have sufficient negative bias voltage. And the requirement, you saw that the load resistance should have a less value when it compares with the internal resistance of the photodiode, because you need to have much range of current to work in the photo conductive mode. And so this equation, so just forget about what is given here. So this equation, V out equal minus ID RL, you saw a moment ago how that was come. So this is how it came. V out equal minus ID RL, right? So what is ID? ID is the diode current. So how you get the diode current in reversed by a smot. So ID you saw. ID. This is the ID is given by this equation. The dark reverse saturation current times this one minus the photocurrent. This one minus the photocurrent. That is this characteristic. I mean this part of this. So this is applicable for this part also. But we are only interested in this part, right? So you have this is actually ID. ID. So the subscript key is not given here, but it is the ID that is the diode current. So you can represent the ID by this. So V out is equal to minus IDRL. You can represent ID by I naught time this one plus. So sorry. This should be actually a minus. Minus this one. Right. So for the reverse current, you get this one, and this is the photo current times the load resistor times the load resistor. So you can represent from the previous equation everything, and you get the equation. So the output voltage you can get something like this. So just you replace what is the value for ID. From the previous equation you learned for the photoconductivity, right? So if you get this one, right? For a given bias voltage, right? So a given bias voltage, so V out is varying for a given bias voltage. V out is varying with respect to PS. That means the incident photon power of the incident photons. So this is load line. This is the line which we drew in this case. This is how it can vary. That is, this is the range where the ID can change. This is the range where the ID can change, right? When you multiply it by RL, you get the output voltage, right? So the range of values for which you can change ID. Right, so for the range of values where you can change ID, you get by the input power, because in that mode this bias voltage, so in other terms the voltage, the VD is not changed. VD is not changed, so it is assumed to be constant. So this is directly a function of input power. But when it comes to practically, right? So even though you don't change the bias voltage, the VD will change, right? So the VD will change from this one to. So it will, the VD will move like this when it goes from this one to here, and ID will change from like this one to here, right? But for V out, you have the changing current, right? So it follows this DC load line, which is linear, right? So you obtain that by subjecting the divode current. Here, subjecting the divode current here, you found this DC load line, and here you have made the assumption that this ID is obtained with a fixed load resistance. So when you change the load resistance, this will change, but you assume that the load resistance is constant, which is practically the case where the load resistance, we don't usually change the load resistance, right? So that is that one. So next we will consider the photovoltaic mode. So first we'll have a graphical analysis, then go for the equation. So in photovoltaic mode, so the name photovoltaic says that using the incident photons or light, voltage is generated. So when you generate voltage, you don't supply voltage. So there are no biasing voltage supply applying for this one. There is no bias voltage applied. Just there is a load resistor connected to a diode, And using the same conventions as before, you can mark the diode current and voltage for the diode, right? Okay, and then now you can write the using the Kirchhoff voltage law, you get V out is equal to, again, minus IDRL. V out is equal to minus IDRL. And what about VD? And VD is also equal to now V out. But in this case, VD was not equal to V out. VD equal minus VR plus V out in this case. But here, VD is equal to, I mean, the diode voltage is equal to the output voltage. Whatever the voltage appears across the diode will be output. That means we can extract that voltage. Because there was no voltage initially, so this acts as a voltage generator. So without supplying any voltage, you can get an output voltage. How that voltage is generated? That voltage is generated due to the reverse bias current. You can see in this characteristic, when photons are incident, there will be a reverse bias current due to the drift current. So due to that drift current, there will be a voltage across this one. And that voltage in this case, as there is no voltage supply, it will be a positive voltage. It will be a positive voltage which can be extracted out. So this is the one which is used in which can be used in solar cells in order to generate voltage from light. So millions of this kind of diodes are included in solar cells in order to get voltage, and this voltage can be some collected to get some level of output voltage, right? That's how the solar cells are working. And what is the condition? So how, when you write the equation, you get V out is equal to minus IDRL. So our output, desired output is output voltage, V out. We want to make this high. If we want to make this high, we have to either increase the diode current or the load resistance. So more than increasing diode current, it is easy to increase the load resistance. So in the photovoltaic mode, the condition is the load resistor needs to be much higher than the internal resistor. That is the condition, because you can easily control the load resistance. But in, on the other hand, in the photoconductive mode, RL need to be much less than RS, as I told you using this load line. But in here, this is something like Y equal MX, right? So in order to get this more voltage, you have to get this load resistance higher. Higher the load resistance, then you get higher voltage output. But this diode current is not only controlled by this load resistance. This diode current is depending, just like here, it is depending on both the incident photon power, right? It is depending on the incident photon power and several other parameters, which will be discussed now. And so you can see, this is not linear, right? So that non-linearity comes as a result of other external factors, which will be driving this mode, right? So we'll see what those are. So as told you, it needs a higher load resistance, right, in order to have much higher forward bias voltage output, simply. So as you saw the graph, it was not linear, it was varying something like log 1 plus x. That is the shape of log 1 plus x, right? Okay. So this is the requirement, and you can have the output voltage something like this. So here also, V out is equal to minus ID RL. V out is equal to minus ID RL. And this is some equation which has been approximated for this IDRL, right? IDRL. This has been experimentally found that it is not following this kind of linear relationship. This is an experimental equation. It is not going to work with the incident photons, but it is changing with the log value of 1 plus x, right? The log value of 1 plus the current, the photo current. And this is I naught. These symbols have the usual meaning, which is the reverse saturation current in dark conditions, right? So this is the absolute temperature, and this A is a constant. A is a constant. Right. So now this is experimental equation which has been found by researchers. So this is just directly given to you, and you don't need to worry about how this equation came. Just what you need to know is that it is non-linear. The photo, the DC load line, or in other terms, how the output voltage appears, right? So ID times RL, even though you have the load resistor a constant, as the current will be nonlinear, the output voltage will be nonlinear. That means it kinds of have some it begins to saturate when it goes to higher voltage values. That means when you have less voltage, right? So it is first begin to rise something like linear, then it the output current begins to saturate, right? So how that happened is not derived or given here, because it is out of the scope and it is not required. Just what we are interested is not actually this mode also. What we are interested, what we are focusing is this equation, which is the photoconductive mode, right? Photo generation, that is some another part, which is therefore power generation. So this is the one as a photon detector. This is the much needed equation, right? Okay. So this it is given here. This A can be a value between 1 and 2, right? Okay. So we will see more about some small details more about this one. So in the photoconductive mode, as I told you, energy is supplied by the external bias voltage applied. So not only in the photoconductive mode, but also in photo emission mode also. So both in photo emission mode and photoconductive mode, you need to have external voltage supply in order to give a forward or reverse bias voltage. In photoconductive mode, you have external voltage supply to bias the diode in reverse bias. In photo emission mode, you have an external voltage source to bias the diode in forward bias. But in photovoltaic mode, you do not have an external voltage source, but the voltage will be generated. That means energy is not supplied. Energy is extracted in photovoltaic mode. That is the difference that you need to understand between these three types of modes, right? So energy is generated and it will be extracted from the external circuit. And so due to that, they are used as small energy generation cells in solar cells, right? That photovoltaic mode is the one which is used. So not only the photodiodes, this PN junction diodes are used. There are some, the solar cells can be made from some other type of photo generative material. So for these PN junctions are one of them. So that is the end of photon detectors and also semiconductor LEDs and laser diodes. Now, so all of the things that you learned up to this moment. So what are the things that you learned? So you learned massively in this photo emission mode and photoconductive mode, and you almost didn't learn any application on this. The solar cells, I told you, any other specific working principle in this mode, but specifically we discuss on these two modes. And if you notice that all of these transducers were analog transducers, all of them, LED lasers and photodiodes, none of the them were digital. In the real world, most of the sensors will behave analog. But when it comes to applications, it is difficult to deal in analog domain. We'll see why. That's why I decided to conduct a session on digital sensors. Digital sensors. This section has not been taught in previous years, but I introduced it in this year. So we'll discuss what a digital sensor is and why I specifically chose to discuss about this one. Okay, we'll have first a comparison. So what we learned up to this moment were analog, right? So, but the case is, if you go and search the transducers or sensors, especially sensors, because the sensors, the output is electrical sensor. That is the definition of a sensor. The output should be electrical. When it comes to electrical domain, analog domain is difficult to handle, and unless specified for the particular application. For example, in coming lessons, you will be learning about piezoelectric transducers, where you have, in the sensor, acoustic to electrical, and it can also convert from electrical to acoustic also. As we are discussing about sensors, I got only the acoustic to electrical. So in that case, the output is analog. And so usually what you give as the input to the transducer is a sinusoidal waveform, and you get the output also as sinusoidal waveform. In such kind of cases, you cannot get digital outputs, because the output should be sinusoidal. So there are some there is a requirement. And when you have diodes, I mean not only diodes, any transistor or any other resistive element as the thermal sensor. So the temperature, in order to monitor a temperature, you need to have a long range of values. I mean, a continuous range of values. For example, from 0 degrees Celsius to say 100 degrees Celsius, if you want to get a thermometer, right? So you need to get a long analog range of values. So typically in the photon detectors that we discussed in light to electrical, right? Unless it is used for some digital communication. So in digital communication, photon detector is used in digital domain. But if you have the modulation of or the light output as an analog output, then you need to, the photon detector must also work in analog domain. So you are, if your application is analog application, you will have to use these analog sensors. The sensors are inherently analog. That is no debate on that. But analog sensors are difficult to handle and less used in the modern world. You will see the reasons for that. But if your application is analog, you must use it analog. So for your project, if your application is analog, then no need to think twice. Then you must obtain a PO analog transducer for your application. Otherwise, so due to the advantages of the digital systems, such as finite number of outputs are there. So just like analog, so in analog you have infinite number of output values because it is continuous. And in analog domain, it is very almost impossible to process the signal received. So if the for example, if you get the output of the acoustic transducer or the acoustic sensor, which is a sinusoidal waveform, you cannot simply provide that to a digital circuit and analyze it. What is the output? So you have to get it converted to a digital signal first by an analog to digital converter, then you can process. So, and due to this digital signal processing techniques and due to the development of analog to digital converters, which can easily convert an analog signal to a digital signal. And most importantly, the storage capability. of digital signals. So digital signals can be stored as bits in memory. So the output of an analog waveform, you cannot store it and retrieve it later. But if it was digital, you can store it as bits in memory easily. I mean, there are techniques, there are complex techniques to store an analog signal in media. So that is a different story. But those techniques are now outdated. In modern world, digital is a system which you can easily store some signal and retrieve it later. So due to these advantages, many of the analog sensors that we discuss in the course content are packaged as digital transducers or sensors. That means that analog transducer or sensor is not there as an isolated sensor. It is packaged with other sophisticated electronic components which will convert that transducer into digital domain and give out the digital output or input based on what is the transducer. So due to that one, those advantages, so most of the sensors are packaged as, so what you get as the functional diagram of a sensor is actually digital in modern world, right? So this thing you need to note, right? For instance, I have taken this video camera sensor, which I and a set of students used in the previous year for a project, right? So in this one, so the specific camera we used was OV7670 video camera sensor. So the term sensor is important. So what does the sensor does? It gets some input from one domain and converts it to electric. So what does the video camera sensor does? It gets the light output from the environment and convert it to an electric signal. So if you get the analog sensor, this is the analog sensor where it will detect the light intensities in the real world and output as electric signals. But those electrical signals are analog. That means continuous, right? It is continuous. And so what is needed to be done? So those analog intensity levels need to be converted into discrete levels. So you must have heard about RGB channels. So typically the red, green, blue is represented by 8 bits. Red 8 bits, green 8 bits, blue 8 bits. So what is that 8 bits? That is the quantization level. That means the analog output is divided into 2 to the power 8. That means 256 discrete intensity levels, not as an analog output. That is what which is happening inside this analog processor. It will analyze and convert it to a digital signal using this analog to digital convert. Right? So for the user, if you get this signal as analog sensor, then user need to create this analog processor, user need to create this analog to digital converter and all of these circuits. if you take by the analog sensor only. So the advantage of digital sensor is, so with the analog, you already have the analog sensor and you have the EEC domain digital signal. I mean, it will be converted internally into a digital signal, and not only conversion, analog to digital conversion, but it will also be enhanced. It will be passed here. In this example, it will be passed through a digital signal processing block where the image is more enhanced. So here they have given the enhancements which are done, white correction or lens correction, whatever the enhancements. Then the image signal scaling, scale the image to the value required by the user. For example, there are different resolutions requirements from the user. According to those resolutions, the image can be scaled. And then, so not only that one, you can store the retrieved image. So this FIFO stands for first in, first out buffer, which is a memory where you can store frames of images. So what you detect can be stored. So if it were analog, you won't be able to store this much easily. So now after this one, you don't have analog signal. What you have is either digital low voltage level or digital high, either zeros or ones, or in other terms, what you have is bits. So bits can be stored in memory and later required when required. So this D 7 down to 0 is the eight bits which are extracted parallelly. There are 8 ports. So those values in the 8 ports will represent a color, right? Okay, so this is an example. So I have given here the description what is done. So this is the analog image array. So the intensity level are sampled by this X clock. So X clock is the external clock, which here acts as the sampling clock. So in analog to digital conversion, you must have studied by now, you have sampling and quantization. So X clock is here the sampling clock. And it is quantized into 8 bits. And here you can see that means the analog signal is quantized into 256 levels and passed through DSB scale and most importantly stored in memory. Where the user, the required user can interface this sensor. That is interfacing, that means connect with this sensor or transducer and obtain the required inputs or outputs, right? And the other thing, which is there with the digital sensors, is you can configure the internal parameters of a digital sensor or transducer. So if this was a single analog transducer, there are fixed parameters. So even inside this digital package, you are not able to convert what is happening in this analog sensor. What you are actually controlling is other digital domains where you can get desired outputs by configuring the parameters in the digital domain. So if you can remind about the photon detector, the analog transducer that we discussed a moment ago, it had several performance parameters. So what were, if you can remember, the signal to noise ratio was one of them, the frequency response, the speed response, right? The dynamic range, So those were some of the performance evaluation parameters. Those were fixed for a particular given photon detector. Those were fixed. You cannot change. Even still here in the analog sensor, you cannot change those things because that is how that sensor is designed or inherently there. But using the digital techniques and digital processing techniques, we can, when we are converting into digital domain, we can change the parameters of conversion. That means, for example, in this case, you can get different resolution images, different quality level images, different color representation images, different white balanced images, images at different refresh rates. That means usually it is 60 hertz. So if you can change, or we say we configure the sensor. You can configure. In other terms, change the parameters such as, for in this example, sampling frequency, intensity levels, color scales, just like now I told you. How we are going to do that? So inside these digital sensor packages, you have something called registers. So register is what? A memory unit having specific address. So any memory should have an address in that particular device. So if you refer the data sheet of this device, you have a set of registers, right? So those registers are storing the tunable parameters of this digital sensor package. Registers are storing configurable or tunable parameters of this device, such as this one, such as this one. So in order to get the desired output, you can change those parameter values. You can change those parameter values to get the required output. So in the analog sensors, the output is almost fixed. You cannot configure. But in digital, this is also one of the biggest advantage of digital sensors, where you can configure the sensor or the transducer. But in order to configure, you have to communicate with the device. So you can see there are, so this is the output. This is just the output. But in order to get the output, so this is the image output. So you have some different inputs, right? So you need to give a signal X clock, that is a clock signal, where you want the sampling frequency of this sensor to be, of this analog to digital converter. And if you want, you can, using this power down, you can shut this sensor off. You can, using the reset, you can reset the whole device. Resetting means loading the default values for these memories. Loading the default values. Default values means factory manufactured or factory set values. So initially, the configurable parameters have some value. Those values are called the default values. So you can externally control this. But you can see, in order to configure or tune or change the parameters, you need to communicate with the sensor. So in this particular sensor, you have a way of communication. SIOC and SIOD, serial input output clock and serial input output data. So you need, so different sensors have different communication protocols. Communication protocol is a standard of rules of communicating with between multiple parties. Rules of communication between multiple parties, that is what you call a protocol. So in this case, in this particular example, it is using the communication protocol known as the I2C communication protocol. I2C. So in this lesson, I will explain what is I2C, and there are two more communication protocols. So unlike analog sensors, in order to get the tunable parameters, change the tunable parameters, you need to communicate with the device. If you don't communicate with the device, you may not even get an output. You may get a distorted image likewise, right? So because of that one, communication with the digital sensor is an important thing. Okay, so this slide is very important. So this point you need to understand. So you don't need to understand how a sensor works in order to get the desired output from the sensor. Keep this as a tip. I mean, when you are doing the projects, you don't need to know how the low level details. For example, for a photo detector, in order to get the output photo current, you don't need to know how what is internally happening there, what is the internal photoelectric effect, how the incident photons are going to cause noise, short noise, thermal noise, signal to noise ratio, how the photo generated current is generated using the, if it is a photodiode, how it is generated using drift current. Any of those things you need not to learn. That is the true story. But for interfacing, you don't need to know about that. You need to know about how, most importantly, how to communicate with the sensor in order to tune the parameters of the sensor and obtain the output. But don't use this one as a guide to not study the working principle. Knowing the working principle is very important, but knowing it does not make any project improvement. That's what I wanted to highlight it. So knowing some basic knowledge in high level, for example, if it is an image sensor, okay, the video camera, the sensor is getting a light input and converting into electrical bits, pixels. That is the only thing you need to learn. So that is something in high level. So in low level, you don't need to know how this each bit is produced, how that analog transducer is working. You don't need to learn in order to do the project, but you will be tested on low level working principles such as a photon detector and LED laser. All of those working principles will be tested in theory in exams. But for the projects, what I'm highlighting is that knowledge is useful but not essential in order to get something out from a sensor. There are more important things, more than knowing the working principle, when it comes to interfacing with specifically digital sensors, right? What is more important, I have given here. So the first thing is whether the performance features or the parameters match with your application, right? So if I compare this one with what we have learned in previous lessons. So for examples in photon detectors, whether the spectral response is in a range that we need for the application. So if you are using the photon detector for communication application, whether that spectral response will be or the frequency response will be in the range that we required for the speed of the application, whether it will be sufficient enough, whether the noise equivalent power is enough to detect low level signals, such as when a signal is received from a very distant point, whether the noise equivalent power will come into it. Likewise, you must compare the sensor or the transducer with the desired application, right? So that this is more important than studying the low level details of the sensor working principle, whether the application match with your sensor. That is the first thing you need to understand. Then the next thing which is most important is how to communicate with the sensor in order to get the desired output from the sensor. I mean, to configure the registers inside sensor. So even if you get a LED display, even if you get an accelerometer, digital accelerometer, even if you get a wireless transceiver, even if you get a video camera like the one that I showed you. So almost all of these things, you need to configure the internal registers. So in order to configure the internal registers, you need to communicate with the transducer. So how to communicate? You must know. Without knowing the protocols for communication, you will not be able to communicate with the sensor and get what you want. Because what you want may not be the default settings of the sensor. You may need to adjust those parameters for your particular application. For example, if the sensor is a distance detector, for example, your sensor may be a radar sensor where you emit a radar signal. So radar is a radio wave is emitted, and based on the time it is receiving, you can calculate the distance to a barrier in front of you. So those sensors are now modern days used in self-driving cars. So those radars, they are to detect the near obstacles to the vehicle. So likewise, in such cases, you may need to, in that example, you may define the maximum range of the radar. That means maybe 5 meters. It will only detect up to 5 meters, or maybe it will detect only up to 50 meters. Likewise, so how to change that parameter, the maximum detectable distance of the radar. So that is done by configuring the registers of the sensor. For that one, you need to communicate with the sensor, digital sensor, right? So because of those reasons, you need to have a very good knowledge about the communication protocols. So what is communication protocol? It is a collection of standard rules that govern the communication. That means you cannot violate the rules of communication and communicate. In order for some sender to send some data to a receiver, you need to you must go with that standard rules. You cannot violate those and communicate simply. So when it comes to the sensors and transducers world, there are three basic communication protocols that you need to understand in order to communicate with a digital sensor, right? The first one, this thing you may have already learned. I don't know whether you have learned or not. UART is, I think you know, it stands for Universal Asynchronous Receiver and transmitter. Just I am introducing here, and we will be discussing one by one separately. And the second one, I square C, also called I2C, it simply stands for inter-integrated circuit. So it is specifically a communication protocol introduced to communicate between integrated circuits, I mean ICs, electronic ICs, right? That's why it had got the name inter-integrated circuit, where you only have two wires to communicate. So I square C is the one which has been used to communicate with this camera sensor. So serial input output clock and serial input output data. So using that protocol, you can communicate with this sensor. Right. The second one is inter-integrated circuit, and third one is SPI, serial peripheral interface. So these are the three communication protocols used to interface with digital sensors, right? And out of these, UART is rarely used. And if you, so when you refer the data sheet of a digital sensor, it tells the communication protocol it supports. Some sensors supports, maybe it support all of them, or maybe it support only two of them. But the requirement is at least one of the, any digital sensor should be able to be configured using at least one of these protocols, at least one of these communication protocols. And I2C and SPI are the ones which are mostly or more commonly used by digital sensors. UART is sometimes used, not most of the time, sometimes this is also used. Because these three communication protocols have their own advantages and disadvantages, right? Some are fast, some require only less amount of wires, likewise, and some support full duplex communication. That means communication at the same time in same directions, both directions. Likewise, some only support communication in one direction at one time. That means half duplex. So likewise, there are advantages and disadvantages between these three protocols. Right. We'll go one by one. First, we'll get UART. This is the one I think you are most familiar with. I think you are familiar with this one. So for each of the protocols, I will provide you the architectural diagram and bitstream, or the, in other words, called the timing diagram. Right. So this is how the communication takes place between multiple parties of the protocol. So for example, what is given in this box may be the UART of your Arduino microcontroller. This may be UART of your Arduino microcontroller. This may be UART of your sensor. This may be UART of your sensor. And in sensor, so for example, just considering example, so you have two ports, the transmitter and receiver ports. So from the transmitter, you will, I mean, any party, whatever it has the TX port, it will always send, that means give out data. The port RX will always receive data. But the disadvantage of this one is, this symbol rate, or in other terms called, known as the baud rate of communication, must be same for both parties. I mean, this baud rate, this one, if you consider this one as the your sensor, the sensor's baud rate and the microcontroller or your Arduino's baud rate must be same. If they are different, you will not be able to have the communication. And this is one full bit stream to transmit one byte of data, right? So when you get the architecture, you have baud rate generator and transmitter and receiver pair. So if you want, you can consider, I mean, you can remove, if you want, you can remove one line completely. Then this will become only the receiver and this will become only the transmitter. And if you remove this line, this will become only the transmitter and this will become only the receiver. And if you have two lines, both can act as transmitter and receiver. That means transceiver. Okay. So if you get what is baud rate, it is just a clock divider. I mean, there is a initial frequency, I mean, a rate, right? You can achieve different baud rates by dividing that frequency, right? So that is how the baud rate generator works. So that is, so due to this one having I mean, whatever this transmitter or receiver, this one having different baud rate generator and this one is having different baud rate generator. So this is asynchronous. So this one need to know about if this is the receiver, this one no need to know when this is going to start transmission or stop transmission. They will be automatically detected from the input bit stream. So by having this start bit and stop bit, whenever you have the start bit, you the receiver knows that, okay, the sender is now going to send the data. Whenever you have the stop bit, the receiver knows, okay, now the sender has stopped sending data. Likewise, there is no need to have some kind of synchronous operation between this one and this one. This one can behave independently from other one. That's why it's called asynchronous. But the fact is, even though they are asynchronous, both of them should have the same baud rate, otherwise communication will not be possible. Right, as I told you, data is received from RX and transmitted through TX. Okay, so what is considered as a start bit is a transition from high to low. Because you have some condition known as idle condition. In idle condition, logic high is transmitted. That means the bit is high in idle condition. In idle condition, bit is high. Idle condition will vanish when the receiver sees a high to low transition or 1 to 0 transition in the input incoming bit stream received by the receiver. If it see there is high to low transition, okay, now the receiver knows that now it is going to send a bit stream. Then it will actually send, I mean, in the receiver, it will receive 8 bits, bit 0 to bit 7. That means one full byte. So this UART is used for usually ASCII character transmission. ASCII character transmission, or maybe in device configuration, this may be a register address of 8 bits. Or maybe this is a register data. So if this is a sensor, this is having registers. So the first byte will be the register address. Address in the register, then it will be the register data. So likewise, it will differ. And so you can send 8 bits of data, and then at last the stop condition. So stop condition is 0 to high transition after these 8 bits are transmitted. After 8 bits are transmitted, 0 to high or low to high transmission indicates to the receiver that the communication has now stopped, and after that it will go to the idle condition where the logic level is high, right? That's what happens in UART communication. So as I told you, by removing one or the other of these wires, you can configure this one in full duplex, half duplex, receiver or transmit mode only. So if you remove one wire, right, it will become actually transmit or receive mode only. That means duplex communication will not be possible if you remove one of the wires. That means if you remove this wire, this will only act as a transmitter and this will only act as the receive. So it will be simplex, or in other terms, only one directional or unidirectional communication. If you have both wires, you can communicate either in full duplex or half duplex mode. What is full duplex? Full duplex means transmitting and receiving at the same time. Or if you want, you can transmit at one time and receive at one time. That is half duplex, right? So this is how the UART, or the universal asynchronous receiver transmitter protocol, operates. This thing you may have learned earlier. Now we will move on to the second communication protocol that is required to interface with digital sensors, that is serial peripheral interface. So now I'm explaining you in the order which the complexity of the communication protocol increase. So UART is the simplest. SPI, I think it is the most next moderate level. And I2C, I think it is the hardest to grasp. And here also I'm giving you the architectural diagram and the timing diagrams for read and write operations, right? Okay, so first you need to understand the architecture. So in UART, how many wires you had? You had only two wires. But in SPI, or the serial peripheral interface, you need to have, at least four wires. At least four wires. And if you have, so this has something called master-slave architecture. Master-slave architecture. So if you compare this one with your sensor or transducer, your sensor or transducer will act as the slave. Your sensor or transducer will be the slave. The microcontroller, typically what you know is Arduino. Arduino will be the master, right? Where you send the commands and clock signals, right? In UART, the clock signal or the baud rate generator, there were two separate baud rate generators for the two components which were involved in communication. And the advantage of SPI, another advantage of SPI is using one master, you can control many slaves. But for instance, using one Arduino microcontroller, you can control one sensor here, and another SPI slave acting as another sensor. What you need to change in order to communicate with, in order to select which sensor you want to communicate, you can change this line, the slave select or the chip select line. Slave select or chip select will select the required slave or the required sensor out of the multiple sensors you have to configure. You can connect many sensors and select the sensor to configure using the chip select or slave select. So the number of fires of slave select or chip select will be equal to the number of slaves, or in other terms, the number of sensors you need to configure. But these three wires, MOSI, MISO, and serial clock, you need to have separate wires. Now we will see what these MOSI, MISO, and serial clock are. So MISO stands for master input slave output. So as this is the master, you can see in this arrow, this is an input to the master and output from the slave. So this is called master input slave output. And here, this is an output from the master and input to the slave. So it is called master output slave input. For the slave, it is an input. For the master, it is an output. It is called MOSI, master output slave input. And the other one, this is serial clock, also called SCLK or SCK, whatever the abbreviation. This serial clock, it is produced from the master. Master is the one responsible for producing the serial clock and providing to the slaves, I mean, provided to all the slaves. So if you have multiple slaves, these three lines will be connected to all the slaves parallelly. That means, I mean, whatever connected to those lines will be changed, right? Okay, so serial clock and master output slave input. So those things are not changing. And so this SS stands for slave select or chip select. That is the wire which is going to select what is the device that you are going to configure. And so there's a small mistake. So the not only the slave select, but also the MISO, because there is one wire from MISO also. So there is a small mistake here. So this should be two. I mean, the MOSI and serial clock will be common to all of the slaves. I mean, if there are 10 sensors, you will have only two MOSI and serial clock, because they are common and connected parallel. But from each of the slaves, there should be a MISO. And to each of the slaves, there should be a chip select or serial select. So this will be 2 plus 2. Where n is the number of chip select or actually CLK. Sorry, not CLK, MISO. Right, so just I corrected this one. So there will be 2 plus 2 n number of wires. Okay, so I hope the architecture is clear. So from the master, you have three output wires, which are MOSI, yeah, the MOSI and serial clock are common to all slaves, and individual inputs from the each of the slaves MISO, and individual outputs to select the slave from the master, right? So now we will see what is the purpose of each of these MOSI and MISO. So MOSI is used to transmit the data from master to slave. Not only data, but also control. So what is data and control? So for example, consider this SPI write operation. So you can see there is a serial clock change. And when you want to select a particular device or a slave, what you do is you make this chip select or slave select low. When you make the chip select or slave select low, then that means that device is selected. That device is selected, right? when the device is selected, you can use the serial clock, right? And what you do is you change the data. So for example, if it is MOSI, you change the data at negative edges of this serial clock. So you can see this data, this the data are changed at negative edges of this serial clock. And it will be captured by the slave at positive edges. So the slave will capture these signals at positive edges of the clock. So the master changed the data at negative edges of the clock for the slave to be captured at positive edges of the clock, serial clock. And the slaves have no control over this clock. The clock is totally controlled by the master. There is only one master, which is typically your microcontroller, which you need, which you are going to connect to the sensors. And you can see this first 8 bits are marked with C, and the next are marked with D. So the first is a command or the control. So the first set of 8 bits is a command. And this is the command, I mean, the data for the command. For example, I took this from a wireless transceiver module. I took this as a timing diagram from a wireless transceiver module. So what it does is this command. So this command is the command for, say, example, is to transmit a set of data. So the master says, okay, now this is the command for transmitting the data. Then after that command is transmitted, after a short interval, the next set of data which need to be transmitted will be sent to the slave, or here in this case, the wireless transceiver. And then those data will be transmitted, right? So that's how this write operation performs. So when the command is transmitted from MOSI, what will be shifted, I mean, which will be input from MISO is set of status. Whenever you give a command from MOSI, the MISO will give the status of the sensor. This status can be used to detect the status of the sensor. So using the MISO. So when you give a command, whenever you give a command, MISO will give the status bits. So this S7 to S0 stands for the status bits of the sensor. So you can have an idea about the status of the sensor also using MISO. Right. So all of the commands and data are transmitted whenever that sensor is selected by using chip select or sensors, the slave select goes to zero. And when it is set back again to high, if you change anything from this one, they will not affect the communication, because the communication after this one, anything in these lines are not considered, because that particular sensor or the slave is not selected, simply. So in the slave side, it has MISO. So if it is an SPI read operation, so for example, if in case of an image sensor, so from the master or the microcontroller, you can give a command like, okay, now give me the input image from the sensor. I mean, I will give a command like, give me the input image in the sensor. Then after that, after sending the status, then the slave or the sensor will now send the data which was stored in the sensor. Because what was read by the sensor, whatever the image, if it is an image, or if it is something data received from somewhere else. So as it is a digital sensor, it can store. And when we give a command like this, okay, give me whatever you have in the sensor, then those you can retrieve from the sensor. This is the data, which is sent using MISO from the sensor to the master. So if this is, say, an image sensor, this will send the raw image data to the microcontroller, where the microcontroller will either store it or provide to an output device like LCD display. The microcontroller will decide what to do to that. So this is how you can read and write using SPI or serial peripheral protocol. And as I told you, the serial clock is totally in control of the master, and the slaves or the sensors do not have to generate those things. So this is one of the key things why UART is rarely used in sensors, because in UART you need to create the baud rate. You need to have an external additional input to decide the baud rate. So in here, the clock is totally decided by the microcontroller or the master. So the sensor does not need to worry about the data rate or anything. That's why these are SPI and I2C communication protocols are preferred by sensors, not UART. Right, so we'll see more about this one. So even though I explained this one individually, so what will happen is these steps, right? So what will first occur is the serial clock is generated, and the data rate is usually is in megahertz. That means SPI communication is a fast way of communication between sensors and transducers. SPI is found to be the most, actually the highest data rate is found in these one, because it has some kind of parallel architecture where you can have the full duplex mode. But in UART, there is a maximum, there's a limitation in the UART protocol. The UART is specifically designed for low data rate applications, and the next protocol that we will be discussing is I2C. That is even worse. The data rate is even worse than this. Right. So because of that, SPI is very good to transfer some things like images or very high data load from the sensors, right? Or maybe to transfer data to a display device, something like for transferring loads, high loads, you can use this because of higher achievable data rate in megahertz range. So after the master generates the clock, then initially, this chip select line is high. When this chip select line is high, there is no sensor selected, or the communication is not possible. So first, in order to start the communication, this chip select line should be made low, right? Then data will be out, data, or maybe if it is a command, it is a control command, will be output from the MOSI. And using the MISO, it will be, the status will be shifted, right? And it will occur at each of these serial clock pulse. As I told you, the MOSI will output at the negative edge of the serial clock, and the slave will read it at the positive edge of the clock. So positive edge is this rising edge, negative edge is this falling edge of the clock, right? So after end of the communication, this will be asserted back to high to stop the communication. And using this, you can achieve full duplex communication at high speed, right? At high speed, so SPI is a very good way of communication, but the disadvantage is it is having at least four wires for communication. So even though it is higher, you need more number of input outputs. That is a disadvantage. So you have pros and cons in each protocol types. Okay, this is the last protocol that we have to discuss. This is I2C. Due to this one, you don't see the title correctly. This is I2C protocol. So this thing is somewhat maybe difficult to grasp for you at once, but with time you will be able to capture this one. So even though it looked like simple, but it is actually hard because you have some things to understand in this timing diagram. So in I2C architecture, you have like UART, you have only two wires, serial clock and serial data. Serial clock and serial data. And for the slave, right? For the slave, even though the number of slaves are increasing, you can use the same two wires. So in SPI, you need to have different, I mean, the wires will increase by two, as you saw, per each additional slave, or in case, for our case, in for additional sensor you connect, you have to increase the number of outputs or inputs by two. But in this case, for I2C communication protocol, you can connect multiple number of slaves with the same common two wires, which is advantageous in number of wires, but in terms of speed, disadvantageous. Right? Okay, so you can see even though the number of slaves increase, the number of wires do not increase. Right? So what you have is clock, just clock and data. Just clock and data. So this is just like the SPI have the master-slave relationship. So in if we consider our example, the master will be the Arduino, I mean, any microcontroller, and the slaves will be our digital sensors, right? So just like the SPI communication, this has a start condition and a stop condition, start and stop conditions. So you need to understand this one clearly in order to proceed with this protocol. What is known as the start condition is, I mean, for this protocol, when serial clock is high, so this is a serial clock, some clock signal of typically I2C allows up to 400 kilohertz of serial clock, right? So this is some clock signal, and the protocol says that the data is not allowed to change when serial clock is high. Data is not allowed to change when serial clock is high. This is data, serial data, if data has the high to low transition when serial clock is high, like given here, it is said to be a start condition. Because the data cannot change at serial clock high, if the data changes, that will be not data, but a start or stop condition. In start condition, when the serial clock is high, there will be a high to low transition in serial data. In the stop condition, when the serial clock is high, there will be a low to high transition of serial data. That is how you identify the how this one should start communication and when to stop the communication, using the transition of the serial data signal when still the serial clock is high. Right? A high to low transition says that it is a start. Low to high transition says that it is, okay, now stop communication. That is the first thing to understand in this protocol, but not all of it. So after the start condition, so since you do not have separate wires for separate slaves or separate sensors, you need to address these sensors separately. Address means, so this, if you refer the data sheet of any digital device, you will see that device is having a device address. Usually that address is represented by a 7-bit address or 10-bit address. 7 or 10-bit address is assigned for a device, a sensor. So if you have a camera sensor here, and if you have a thermal sensor here, a photodiode here, I mean digital case, if these three have different device addresses, you can use those device addresses to address each of them separately. So after the start condition, what will be transmitted in the next 7 bits or 10 bits, if the device address is 10 bits, will be the address of the slave. Address of the slave will be transmitted next. So if it is 7-bit address, you have up to 2,728 devices. You can connect to this I2C architecture. If it is 10-bit, you can connect 1,024 devices. That is just the number, get the 2 to the power multiple, then you get the number of devices. But that is not something related to this protocol. That is number of devices. So for example, if you set this address to the slave one address, then slave one will respond. Others two will not be respond. Only the communication will take place between the particular address. If it is having multiple, if you have two cameras with the same device address, then both of them will respond, right? If you have same type of devices, then all of those sensors will respond. Then this whole bit stream is applicable for all of them, right? So the device address will be the first thing to transmit. Then after the device address, you have one bit called read or write bit. So which indicates whether whatever the operation which is going to be performed from this master will be a read operation or write operation. Write operation means write to the slave. Read operation means read from slave. That means get information from the slave. So that is indicated using a simple rule. If this read or write bit is 0, then this indicates that it is a writing. That means sending bytes from master to the slave. If read or write bit is 1, then it is a read operation. That means get information from slave to the master. Right? Okay, so we will move on. So now we are here. We started, then transmitted the device address. Then we said that whether it is a read or write operation. And then the next one will not be a task of master. So all of those, serial clock is always driven from the master, but this serial data is not always driven from the master. Okay, the start condition is created by master. The address is set by master. Read or write bit is set by master. But the next bit, the acknowledgement bit, this bit and every other acknowledgement bit is not set by master, but from this acknowledgement bit is set by the slave. So this acknowledgement bit is used to check whether the slave has received what we sent, right? So it is also using some small rule. If the slave or the sender will assert this acknowledgement bit to low for logic level zero, then that means the device has been acknowledged. That means we can continue the communication after this point. If this bit is set high, then that means the slave has, that means none of the slaves, if there are multiple slaves, none of the slaves has responded for our communication. Then what we have to do is we have to restart the communication using, first stop, send the stop condition, then restart the communication to check whether the slave will respond again, right? So this acknowledgement bit is asserted by, assert means set by one of the slaves, which has this device address. If none of the slaves do not have this device address, then no slave will respond. Then the communication will stop. So after an acknowledgement bit, what you have transmit is 8-bit data. So data can be a register address. So if you are going to configure the registers of the sensor, then the first byte of data will be the register address. So first, when configuring the registers, first you want to find the register. That means each of the register in the sensor has a particular register address. So first you need to send the register address, right? Then again, an acknowledgement after sending this. So these 8 bits are again sent by the master. And after that, another acknowledgement will be given by the slave. Okay, now I have received your 8 bits of data. Then after that, you can send another 8-bit data. So typically, this will be the register value. So the first 7 bits will be the device address. Typically, the next 8 bits will be the register address. Typically, the next 8-bit will be the register value, which is the value of the parameter that we want to tune in the sensor. So for example, if this register address is going to change the color intensity of the camera module, so first you need to address that register. For example, address may be a hexadecimal value, 0A is the address of this one. So this, you have to send 0A here. Then if you want to send the particular value, intensity, if it is 0 to 255, you can send the required intensity here. So in that manner, you can configure the sensor. So after this 8-bit also, after each and every 8 bits of data, the slave will respond with acknowledgement, right? So you can transfer any number of bits, 8-bit, this kind of byte streams you want, and at last send a stop condition. What is the stop condition? As I explained earlier, when the serial clock is high, serial data will be changed from low to high. And remember, in all of this middle communication, this serial data should change when the serial clock is low. That is a rule of this protocol. This data and this whatever, these address values or acknowledgement or any of them cannot change when clock is high. They must change. So as you can see here, they are changing at low values of the serial clock. Here also, this at low values. only at start and stop conditions, they are changing at high values of the signal flow. So as I told you, any number of data bytes can be transmitted. That is the requirement. The data should change at low value of the serial clock. And after each byte is sent, an acknowledgement is sent. If this is a read operation, for example, say that this read write bit was set to high, then what will happen? Then this data will be sent not from the master, but from the slave. I mean, in a read operation, slave will send this data. So when the slave is sending data, this acknowledgement will be set by master. For the typical case where the master configures the registers by writing to the registers. But the other way also can happen. The master first get the address and then read from the registers or read from the sensor. Then in that case, this data will be sent from the slave and acknowledgement will be sent from the master. In that case, if the master does not want to receive any more data, then master can send a NAC signal. NAC signal means set this acknowledgement to high. Then the slave will stop sending data, right? So this is how the SPI communication protocol works. And most importantly, you can see that as there is only one serial data line, only either master or the slave can transmit at one time. Both cannot transmit at the same time, like in UART or SPI. In I2C architecture, the master and slave cannot transmit at the same time. So it is called half duplex. Duplex because in both directions you can transmit, but it is half because you cannot transmit at the same time. So I explained the most important three protocols you need to interface with the digital sensors. So that is the fundamental knowledge you need to possess in order to configure a digital sensor and obtain the output from it based on the desired application. As I told you, the working principle is less important, right? I can't say that it is not important, but it's less important. But these are the things which is more important when you come to a project. So from the content that I taught you today, if your project idea was changed, right? You can request me to extend an additional week if your project idea was changed based on the content what I did. If your project idea was changed, you can request to your representative and he will inform me if you request to him to extend the deadline by 1 week for proposal submission. Otherwise, if you are okay with your current proposal, that's fine. Then you need not to inform me, right? No need to send me emails one by one asking me to extend the deadline. You can inform the representative, then representative will inform me. No need to send individual emails, right? That's the update that I have to give you up to this moment. So do you have any questions related to this one or any project or whatever you can ask? Otherwise, that's the end of today's session. I will upload this video to the YouTube today so that you can refer. Right, so thank you.